the sun in summer.
We are back. Thank you very much for being so patient. As I said to you before, the other one was an experiment. And there are some glitches, but thankfully we have a backup. So my guest, Walter Green, the question I asked Walter before the break was, or the interruption was, what is your earliest fashion memory when you were growing up?
Okay, my earliest fashion memory it has to be my mother, because she was a dressmaker. And just being fascinated with fabrics and seeing my mother and my aunts, Aunt Virgie and Muriel, they were all excellent seamstresses, as they called them back in the day in Guyana, workers, or, you know, but they were very creative, and that whole creative aspect of fashion kind of pulled me in. So it was something I saw in my life as a kid. I didn't just decide, okay, I'm going to be in fashion.
And how old were you then?
Oh, my goodness. I mean, you said my earliest memories. I would say when I really got seriously into it, about 9, 10. But I always knew. I always had an eye for color, an eye for fabric. And they exposed me to a lot of the fashion that was around at that time. I remember going to a fashion show at the Tower Hotel, which Lady Sarah Lou Carter gave. And later on, as I was, you know, in school and stuff, I was able to meet her. And she was like sort of a mentor that looked, at that time I was designing, I was just sketching. And she would look at my sketches and she was able to say, well, you know, you've got something in this business, you know.
Wow.
So it was kind of like, you know, a childhood thing and sketching for the Teenage Chronicle and, you know, doing a lot of stuff.
You still sketch to this day?
Not really. Not I don't sketch. I write. I'm a journalist now. I'm a fashion editor. That's the title. Fashion editorial director. But you know, so we do a lot of things.
So the question that comes to mind: what does fashion mean to you?
Well, fashion is everything. I mean, it's so much a part of me. It means a lot. It means fashion is life. Fashion is color. And it's just interesting. It's an interesting question because fashion has changed over the years. And when I started out, like when I first came to the U.S. and stuff, like fashion was not, it was still that very exclusive group. You had to have a ticket. I mean, you still have to have a ticket.
Right.
But nowadays, everybody is in fashion. You know, everybody wants to jump on the bandwagon. Everybody see it as glamour and beauty and, you know, all this wonderful stuff. And you find a singer may have a fashion line, or somebody who had never had any experience with fashion in all their life, all of a sudden they're a fashion designer. And they have a line that's coming out and it's sold in the stores. And you know, and it makes you wonder, it makes you look back to the kids who were studying fashion, who went to school for fashion, who spent years learning to cut and sew and draft and drape. Where does that leave them, you know?
So, okay. You have this group who want to be in fashion,
right?
But is not trained,
right?
May not have much experience. Then you have the other group that do their due diligence, go to school, intern, and so on,
right?
If a young person who has gone through all those different paths, they doing their due diligence, and they come to you and ask you, Mr. Green, what should I do? Do you think I have a future in this? I'm not as aggressive, or I don't like that word, assertive, as those who might not have gone to school and not have intern and so on. You know, I'm the quiet type, but I love fashion. You know, I have the knowledge and so on. What would you say to that?
And they're the quiet type, you said?
Yeah.
There's no quiet type in fashion.
Okay. Tell us a little
you
bit.
You gotta have a backbone. You gotta have some guts. It's not as easy as it seems. We make it look easy. And I've had this discussion with a lot of my friends. I mean, because it's so much a part of us, when you love something, when it's a part of you, it seems very easy to execute.
Right.
And I think a lot of younger people are attracted to that. And they see that we just go through the motions and it looks so wonderful. Mm-hmm. You know, not knowing the work that's put behind it and, you know, some of the valleys and the highs that you've been through.
Right.
So what I would tell a young person, I would tell them they have to really, 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 really want it mm-hmm. and love it. And it has to be a part of them. It has to be a part of their DNA, mm-hmm. you know. It's not an industry for everybody. Mm-hmm. It's not an industry that welcomes everyone with open arms. Mm-hmm. They're still very structured in their way.
Okay.
They're still very prejudiced in their way. Mm-hmm. So you have to have a thick skin and a tough hide to break into this business.
I'm talking about thick skin and tough hide. What kept you going as, you know, during your trajectory within the industry?
That's a good question. I have a tough hide. I mean, okay. I'm very easygoing. I'm very simple. But there's another side of me that comes out that's a warrior.
Right.
You have to be a warrior of sorts. Mm-hmm. You have to know how to break certain barriers mm-hmm. and get what you want. Sometimes it doesn't always happen like that.
It's
a growth process.
It's a growth process. That leads me into something about, you know, mentorship and role models and, well, you know, yes, role models or mentors, those who can guide you through the different, you know, passageways,
yeah.
so to
That's
speak.
That's very important.
Very important. What do you think
about
it?
I had some good role models.
Okay, okay.
I had good mentors. I had people in my life, still have people in my life mm-hmm. that... you know, help me to move from point A to point B. You can't do it alone. It's not something that you do in a solitary thing. You know, you have to have some kind of help along the way. Mm-hmm. And I've had people who've guided me, I must say.
Kay.
You know, I've had angels on my shoulders as well.
That's a good thing.
Yeah.
Are there any young person that you personally mentor or have given some guidance?
So many of them.
So many, right.
On different levels. Mm-hmm. You know, lots of them on different levels. I run into people all the time. I run into young ladies that I've trained mm-hmm. in beauty pageants back in the 90s or whatever. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I don't remember them. They say, "Don't you remember me? You taught me to blah, 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 blah." And, you know, and it makes you feel good. One young lady, she's now a minister, and she said that I taught her to keep her back straight and to walk very proudly. And
very important.
You know, I trained her for a beauty pageant. And it's more than just the training for a beauty pageant. Mm-hmm. I mean, back in the day, we took pride in mentoring these young ladies and helping them not only to go into a it's not just a beauty pageant. It's much more than that. They can use those same skills mm-hmm. to walk into a job interview and get the job, whatever it may be. I mean, as I said, this young lady, she's now a qualified minister. Mm-hmm. So, and she's used tools that we taught her back in 19 whatever.
Wow.
And she went through divinity school and, you know, and she's able to get up on the pulpit and do her thing and still remain beautiful, you know. Mm. So it's a lot of different levels.
What gives you satisfaction in and I'm sure there are different areas that satisfy you, but what gives you satisfaction in terms of a mentor or a mentee? What makes you say, I did my job, or I've made a contribution? What lightens you up?
I mean, situations like what I just explained to you, mm-hmm. stuff like that. It's the little things that count. Mm-hmm. Somebody may remember that you did something nice for them back in the day. A young writer may say, "Well, you know, I remember you published my article or whatever in the magazine, and thank you." And you know, to me, it's the little things.
It's a little.
Yeah.
So most people don't really understand what a fashion editorial director does. Can you tell us what your job entails?
Well, for this publication I'm working with now, I'm pretty much. It's like everything that goes in the magazine comes through. I have to edit everything that's in the magazine.
Oh.
You know, I set up the photo shoots, do the cover work, mm-hmm. lots of the articles, lots of the interviews, and pretty much, you know, channel everything from the writer to the pages.
Okay. I think tonight, I don't know what is happening, but our chat room might have taken a hit. I don't see any comments in there. So someone said that their chat room, their C-box has expired. So it seemed as though it's really a one-on-one between you and me tonight. So I'm going to ask you questions that I have personally, and some that some people have asked me when they saw me post your ad. And you know, I hope that we will get the same kind of effect by the end of this, you know, during the show. So moving right along, what are some of your key accomplishments in the fashion industry?
Key accomplishments?
Yes.
Wow. Well, it's been a long ride.
Uh-huh.
It's still a ride. I mean, just being able to do what I like. There's so many highs and so many lows.
Uh-huh.
One of the students that I talked to, some of the high school kids, asked me what has been the highlight of my career. And I told him I'm still waiting for it. You know, I don't want to get to the point where I'm so comfortable that I did a show with Iman and I've arrived. You know?
Right.
It's not like that.
Uh-huh.
It's always something. Mm-hmm. You know, I've had a lot of good things happen in my career. I've had a lot of not so good things happen in my career. Mm-hmm. But I think as of now, today's what, the 1st of May?
The 1st of the month, yeah.
I've completed my book. So
your
that's
book?
A big thing, yes. I did a book. It's called, what's the name of the book?
Tell us about that, Walter. You know, I love to go with the flow. Tell us about that.
The book is called A Style of Our Own, and it's a history of the Caribbean's most influential fashion designers,
uh-huh.
then and now. So
a history of the Caribbean most influential fashion designers, then and now.
Then and now, yeah.
Why
and
write that book?
Why not? It has not been written. It's part of our history.
Mm-hmm.
And these are over 142 designers that I've met in my career.
Caribbean
designers that nobody knows about. And these designers, they're not only here in New York. They're, of course, throughout the Caribbean. They're in London. They're in Paris. They're all over the world. And it stemmed from a lot of interviews I've done in my career, writing about these young up-and-coming designers, and some are already established designers. And I realized there was no history of it. Nobody can go to one place and see all of these designers from the Caribbean and their stories.
And how long it took you to write this?
It took about, off and on, 3 years. But I can safely say it's done.
It's done.
It's done.
Here
it is. It's done.
Let's see it. I mean, sure.
No, I can't.
You can't. Okay.
It's, you know, stay tuned for further, you know, as we move on. And there is the publishing element. You wrote a book. You know what
yes.
The whole thing is about. But it's something that I've always wanted to do. Mm-hmm. Something that a lot of people encouraged me to do. And there's a need. You know, I have over 27 countries represented, and some countries have like one, like Trinidad and Tobago. I have interviews with over 30 designers.
So when is this going to be released?
I have no idea.
Okay.
It's coming.
Okay.
All I can't give you specifics. You know, there's publishing stuff that's still being worked out. The main thing is that it's done.
It's done.
Yeah.
That's good. That's good. Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Before we take a break, I have this one question. How did you get started in the fashion business? And when did you realize you wanted to become a fashion editorial director?
I never realized I wanted to be a fashion editorial director. I wanted to be a designer when I was a kid.
Uh-huh.
And in Guyana, I wanted to be a designer. I was a designer. And it just kind of grew from that. You know, I didn't know what a fashion editorial director was. You know, I knew I liked to write.
Mm-hmm.
And the memory that comes to me now is as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I shouldn't say a kid. I was a teenager in Guyana. And we would have fashion shows at my school.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew the I knew the editors of the newspapers, and I would tell them I'm doing a fashion show. And they would say, but just write what you're doing. And not knowing, you know, I would just write a little thing, fashion show at Indian Education Trust, you know, blah, 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 who's going to be there. And they would publish it verbatim. And afterwards, they would say to me, you know, you got something here with this writing about fashion. So when I relocated, when I came to the U.S., that's what I studied. That was my major, you know, communications, creative writing, stuff like that. That's what I studied. But it all came back to writing about fashion. I mean, I write about several other things. I write about travel. When I started in the newspaper business here, I wrote about politics. I covered politics. I covered funerals. I mean, I did everything as a writer. So, and I think that prepares you when you get to the point of being an editor or editorial director. You pretty much know what, you know, the whole playing field is about in terms of journalism. And, you know, luckily I did everything. I covered everything.
Wonderful.
You know, but fashion has always been the little thing that triggered me.
That triggered you.
Yeah.
Let's take a break, Walter.
Okay.
Very good answer. I want to thank you so much for your patience. Our chat room is done, but some of the questions are coming in through text. And so we will work with that tonight. One of the questions that came in, our guest tonight is Walter Green, by the way. One of the questions that came in is, what advice would you have for youth who want to get into the fashion industry?
Stay in school.
Stay in school.
And make sure it's something you really, 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 really want to do. Don't be caught up in the glamour and the beauty of it. You know, just make sure basically know that that's your path in life. You know, and get ready not to make a lot of money right away. It doesn't happen like that.
It takes patience.
It takes patience. And don't believe everything you read in the papers of the fabulous lives of these fashion people. And, you know, and there's other areas in fashion. I find a lot of the younger kids, they want to be a model or a designer, and that's it. There's so many layers of this industry that I guess people don't know about. You know, they can be a fashion stylist. You can be a fashion coordinator. Mm-hmm. You can be working in the back rooms, cutting, draping. You can be a backstage coordinator. You can be oh my God, there's so much things in fashion that you know. You can be a fashion publicist. You can be a fashion writer. You can be a blogger. You know, it's just not a designer and a model. That's not the end all be all. It's a huge, huge industry.
And so the other question by Tilly is, what other publication has he worked with? There are a number of questions here. One is, what other publication has he worked with? Let's take that first.
Okay, well, I've worked with several publications. I just had something in Vogue Taiwan. I've worked for Unfold. I've worked for the Financial Times in Canada. I've worked for Panache out of London. I've worked for Visions in Black. The New York Arab News, of course, that's family based. I've been a fashion editor there for a number of years. I've worked for Sister to Sister magazine. I was a fashion editor there. I've worked for Odyssey Couleur. My work has been published in Ebony Man, Black Enterprise, Black Elegance magazine, Caribbean Escapes.
That's a lot,
around.
Walter.
And that's those that I remember off the top of my head.
So what has impressed you about Caribbean designers?
Caribbean designers, they've got a swagger that's very unique. It's something, as the name of the book is, a style of our own. It is a style of their own. Caribbean designers, they have something that I haven't seen in a lot of the mainstream fashion designers. Take, for instance, a young lady I met in Grenada, Veronica Jessamy. I hope I get her name right. She's going to kill me.
All right.
Anyway, but what she does, she's from Grenada, and she takes the spice. You know, and Grenada is known as the Spice Island.
Right.
And all of her fabrics are made with prints. She designed her own prints. That's another area of fashion that a lot of people don't know about, creating your own fabric. You know, you can create your own fabric. You can design your own fabric.
And have it
and
made?
She, yeah. And she takes everything that she designs has the motif of a spice in its varying forms of, you know, of growth. Like the spice when it's a flower, when it's on the leaves of the tree. And she, apart from creating her own fabric, she has incorporated that spice motif into designs that she's done. Like she's made ties with the spice motif on it.
Mm-hmm.
Her dresses, her skirts, even pocketbooks, they all have the spice motif in varying forms. And that's very unique to Grenada, the Spice Island, and it makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
And she took that and ran with it. There's Anya Ayongchi, the winner of from Trinidad and Tobago, who won Project Runway a couple seasons ago. She looked at the ocean, and all of her clothes have this theme of Caribbeanness, the ocean, the sea, the coral, the colors. She looked at the Bobo Shanti, which is the African set in Trinidad, the guys with that wears the big, you know, the dreadlocks. It's part of the Rastafarian cult.
Right.
And they would wear these colors in these belts and kind of a military influence on their jackets.
Mm-hmm.
And she's incorporated that into a modern day style of fashion. Sidella Marley out of Jamaica, who's Bob Marley's daughter,
mm-hmm.
her line Catch a Fire. She took a lot of inspiration from what her dad wore. If you remember the jeans he wore,
yes.
The tight jeans with the seaming down the sides.
Yes.
You know, the body fitted shirts, the denim shirts. You know, and you know, little things like that the Caribbean designers have done. And I can go on and on. I mean, it's 140 of them. But everybody's got their own specific vibe that they've incorporated into their daily wear. And it's quite modern. It's not something that's dated. It's not something that, that you would get tired of looking at. Mm-hmm. It's modern.
I like that. The other question that Tilly had, hold on a second. Do you go back to Guyana, mentor young Guyanese designers?
Absolutely. Uh-huh. Yeah. I started along with a noted Guyanese designer, Sonia Noel. We started Guyana Fashion Weekend 5 years ago. Maybe 6 years ago.
Tell us a little bit about that. 2008.
And it's been going on now for about 7-8 years.
Really?
We started Guyana Fashion Weekend.
What was the reason for that?
The reason was a platform to showcase Guyanese talent. This is something I spoke with Sonia even years before that. Mm-hmm. It took like 3-4 years in the making. I met Sonia Noel in Jamaica mm-hmm. at Caribbean Fashion Week. And we sat around and we realized, Sonia, we need to do something in Guyana. She said, there's so many young designers. You know, what we do, at least for the first couple of years when we went down, we had seminars with these young kids. Mm-hmm. And pretty much, you know, I told them what I did and how to move through this industry. And now it's become a big thing. It's very popular in Guyana. Guyana Fashion Week is, you know, a lot of other islands, they always have, everybody's got a fashion week or a fashion weekend. But Guyana was one of the first, right behind Jamaica.
What sets Guyana apart?
Well, because it's my home, I have a special affinity to Guyana, you know. And there's a link there.
Uh-huh.
You know, and Guyana is so huge. There was two sisters from Wismar, or I think it was Wismar. Mm-hmm. You know Wismar?
Yes.
Now, for those who don't know Wismar, it's a remote area in, you know, it's not a city location. And these young ladies, and when I saw their work, I was blown away. Mm-hmm. They were doing everything that was modern and current. And the wonderful thing about it is they had no access to fashion books or fashion magazines. So they had no way of knowing what was trending in Paris or London or New York.
You know, Walter, I often say on the show that I'm an advocate of the flow.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned trending. So mm-hmm. I'm going to follow that.
Okay.
How important is it to a designer?
It's important in terms of commerce. You have to know what's going on.
Uh-huh.
Even a lot of designers tell me, oh, I don't look at this one or I don't look at that one. They all look at everybody else. Everybody knocks everybody else off, you know. That's why the Caribbean designers are so special.
Uh-huh.
You know? So everybody brings their own thing to the table.
So with that said, going back to these two young ladies, these two sisters.
Right, the Telford sisters.
The Telford sisters.
From Wismar.
What about them?
They just had a natural, modern vibe about their clothing.
Uh-huh.
They were doing bubble skirts and the shorts. We call them hot pants back in the day.
Right.
And they were doing that in Guyana without fashion books, without following fashions. It was just their natural vibe.
What kind of advice would somebody like you, with your experience, give to?
Keep doing what you're doing.
Keep doing what you're doing.
Keep doing it. It may not be what the mainstream is doing right then, but your time will come. If it's really embedded in you,
uh-huh.
your time will come.
You know, I feel cheated, but also
cheated.
Yes, tonight because our chat room is down.
Well, I have to come back when the chat room is
down. Yeah, you have to. But you know, because I believe in faith, I have to be calm and just let the flow do what it is supposed to do here tonight.
Yeah, everything is in divine order.
Yes, exactly. Hey. So here's another question that I got via text. Guyanese women are noted for being well put together and elegant. Is this
Absolutely.
Unique to us?
Absolutely. Hope so. Absolutely. Absolutely. And we did it way before it came fashionable. You know, names like Alexis Harris come to mind. Names like Shakira Bash come to mind.
Yes.
Umblita Van Sleitman. Those women were pioneers. Beryl Pereira. This is going way back. You know, these are the women that set the tone. Sarah Lou Carter came in the 50s, I think it was, or 60s. Because mm-hmm. I remember her as a kid growing up and seeing her style and her flair. And she had a charm school in Guyana. And that models in Guyana were a big thing when I was in school.
Mm-hmm.
And then it kind of died off for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's become popular again, you know? But the thing is with the new kids, They don't know the history. They don't know that we were fashionable way back then. We had 6 winners in the Miss World Beauty Pageant in a consecutive set of years in the 60s.
What?
Shakira, but we all had, they didn't win it, but they were all among the finalists.
Well, okay.
Shakira, they were all like second runner-up, first runner-up, and they were known, apart from their beauty, for their elegance. Mm-hmm. They were known for their individual style, as we say now with the swagger.
So let me, this question comes to mind. And it's prompted by the 2 young ladies, the Telford sisters in Wismar. They didn't have fashion books.
Right.
But they are doing things. Mm-hmm. They're creating fashions that are part of the trend. Being in Guyana, back in those days, these beauty queens, you said they were fashionable and they had their own sense of style.
Mm-hmm.
Not that Guyana was remote, but we didn't have television back in those days.
Mm-hmm.
Those were in the 60s, of course. Where did they get this from? I mean, what influence a style? I mean, I have my own sense of style. You have your own sense of style. I wear what I want, how I want, when I want.
Mm-hmm.
But what causes, what influences a style, a personal sense of style? What goes into that?
Well, the personal sense, that's a question you'd have to ask them. I mean, I have no idea.
No, but in general, you know.
But in general, I mean, people have their own, I mean, I think it's a realness about it.
Okay.
I think it's a realness. It has a lot to do with the climate, because fabrication in terms of being in the Caribbean,
mm-hmm.
we wear light fabrics, we wear bright colors, and we're just very innovative and creative people. I mean, where does it come from?
Mm-hmm.
That's a $1 million question.
Which brings another question to mind. Just before the show, we were playing some Miriam Makeba.
Right.
And you mentioned having seen her.
Yes.
In the what? This
at Queen's College.
At Queen's College in 1969. And then you were telling me about her style.
Yeah.
And the afro. And describe that again. It was you were so eloquent explaining that to me.
What I was saying was that Miriam Makeba, coming from South Africa, came to Guyana and she did a whole Caribbean tour.
Mm-hmm.
Her Afrocentricity was very powerful at that time. You have to look at what was going on in terms of the political climate of the Caribbean.
Uh-huh.
She came there with an Afro hairstyle. A lot of women had never seen that before in Guyana. And the concept of Africa was so totally jaded at that time. I mean, it still is, really.
Yes. Uh-huh.
People see Africa as this, you know, place, which in Africa is one of the most fabulous continents. I mean, the biggest and the best shows I've seen has been in South Africa. Some of the most beautiful women I've seen modeling
mm-hmm.
is from the continent. So here comes Miriam Makeba in the 60s, 70s, whatever, Afro hairstyle, Afrocentric dress. And that was a big influence for women in Guyana at that time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember there was a model there by the name of Lynette. What is Lynette's last name? She's going to kill me too. Lynette Mosley.
Uh-huh.
And she was like the first model of such to be paraded in an Afro hairstyle. And this was like late 60s, I would say. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So the Miriam Makeba was a big inspiration to not only Guyana, but other Caribbean islands. My friend from Trinidad, who designed this shirt here for me, she is she's a Trinidadian designer, Donna Dove, and we talk about
What's
that.
Her name?
Donna Dove.
Donna Dove.
Uh-huh. Yes, and if you want this shirt, you can get it at Brenda Brunson Bay in Brooklyn. Fort Greene.
Where is that? Fort Greene.
Okay. It's on Lafayette Avenue.
Oh, okay.
Brenda Brunson Bay. She has a beautiful boutique on Lafayette Avenue. And Donna Dove, or you can go to donnadove.com. I'm just advertising.
You're plugging, right?
Yeah.
You're plugging.
Because this is
the
her
beautiful
shirt.
Yeah.
And we talk about this stuff all the time about the Afrocentricity,
mm-hmm.
you know. And if you look at this is all hand painted.
Oh, really?
It's wearable art.
Wow.
And you talk about the unique quality of Caribbean designers. Mm-hmm. Look, I'm the poster boy here for this, you know. But in terms of just going back to the whole Miriam Makeba thing,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's an influence that you. It may not seem important. But a lot of people come into your life or you see an image
right.
and you draw from that.
Yes.
You're inspired by that.
Yes. Yes.
And if it inspires one person, it could inspire a whole generation. I've seen that happen.
So who are some of your favorite designers?
Oh my God, you're gonna put me in trouble now.
Just some.
Male designers, female designers, American designers, Caribbean designers.
You got me.
African designers. They're different levels.
You got me there.
I have my favorite designers in Africa. I have my favorite designers in Paris. I have my favorite designers in New York. I have my favorite designers in the Caribbean.
I think this might get us in trouble. Get you in trouble, Walter.
I know. I'm always in trouble, so I'm used to that.
So can I ask who's your style icon then?
My style icon. My personal style icon.
Yeah.
It would have to be Lady Sarah Lou Carter.
Lady Sarah Lou Carter.
The
why?
Wife of Sir John Carter. Because she's a woman of great style. Even now she's like 80 something or whatever, she's still always flawless. Mm. And she's the one that influenced me when I was a kid. Mm. You know, I looked at what she was wearing and I knew she was saying something. You know, the clothes she wore, she brought the fishtail dress into Guyana. I mean, I know a lot of people wouldn't remember this, but you know, when you talk about an icon, is somebody who's made an impression, you know, and who has a lasting legacy. I mean, I was lucky enough as an adult to she's seen one of my shows I did in Jamaica with Iman, when Iman, the first time Iman came to the Caribbean for a fashion show, I was lucky to be on that team. And Lady Carter was able to see some of my work. And she came backstage and she told me she was very proud of what I was doing. And she's seen my writings and she invited us to her home in Kingston. And, you know, so little things like that, you know, for me, that's my style icon.
So Wayne asked, Wayne said, I like the fact that he knows so much about the history of fashion in GTA and the Caribbean. That tells me fashion is really in his blood. Which Caribbean designer would he recommend for Caribbean men today who want to wear something different?
Donna Dove. Francis Hendy.
I'm going to say this here tonight.
DeMarro Brown.
What was it? Donna Dove, who else?
Carlton Brown. I can go on. Ron and Ron from Haiti. The Bagosi brothers. There's so many of them.
Uh-huh.
There's so many of them.
Is there a way, and I got to put you on the spot, is there a way we can find or get a list of our brothers and sisters from the Caribbean who are designers?
You have to read the book.
We have to read the book.
Yes.
So there's no way we can get this before Walter.
That's what I was saying. There's no history of it. All that's right. Why I had to do this book.
I'm going to take this opportunity to say this, to announce this here tonight, that CWS is planning to have another show, another broadcast, or another day's broadcast on another night, specifically for arts and culture. So, I believe that people like Donna Dove and so on will get an opportunity to come on and tell us about themselves and about their designs and so on. Right.
They're fascinating stories. I've interviewed all of these designers, and you have to have. I'm paving the way for all of them to come and talk about it, because the talent is so incredible. Mm-hmm. It's an incredible cadre of designers that we have. I mean, we spend all this money for the Gucci and the Pucci and all these people that take our look and knock it off,
right,
and sell it back to us for $1,000, and we run to the store. Oh, we got to get this whatever designer bag with the Rasta colors on it, which came right out of Jamaica. Mm-hmm. But if a Jamaican had made it and sold it,
nobody
would want to buy it.
That is so true.
Why do we have to keep it, that whole mindset of they're always better than us? We have our own stuff right here. Mm-hmm. It's right here in front of us. Mm-hmm. It's right at the lady at the corner that makes clothes. It's right on Lafayette Avenue in Brenda's shop. It's right uptown in Harlem at Bebe Noir. You know, it's right here.
Walter, I have a feeling, because we have a certain demographics also that look at this show. A lot of guys who love fashion and love to look good. Women too. And I am almost certain, this is why I'm sorry the chat room is down, that there are people out there who are wanting to get that list. You said we have to read the book. Fine, Walter. We don't know when this book is going to be available.
That's part of the mystery.
So we can't go naked between now
Oh, that'd
and
be,
when
that'd
that
be very nice.
Oh. All right, moving right along.
Oh, I forgot it's a family show. Designers are there. You just have to do your research.
Okay.
You just have to research. Ask, word of mouth is the best. There's people out there that know where these people are.
I think I'm going to, I'm going to create a page on CWS website for a listing for our Caribbean fashion designers. I think I'm going to.
Fashion designers, artists, makeup artists, hairstylists.
I said fashion designers, Walter. Yeah.
I'm taking it up to the next level. Because as I said, we don't stand alone. It takes a village.
Okay.
Fashion doesn't stand by itself. You know, art and fashion go together. You know, it's a lot of different elements that make this whole thing work. You know,
I like that principle you talk about, Walter, the principle of the village.
Yeah.
You know, how important it is. Because in our conversations before, it comes up. How important it is to recognize that no one stands alone, and it is relationships that are very important. And I like that. I really like that. It takes a village to make anything possible, right? No one person or one gift can do it alone. Thanks for reminding me of that. It's the question here I have for you is, how do you select models for a photo shoot?
This is a nice one.
Tell it, Walter.
I like a model that has the right attitude. It has nothing, and I want to make this very clear. Mm-hmm. It has nothing to do with being cute or being pretty. It has nothing to do with your boyfriend telling you, oh, you should be a model, you're fine. It has nothing to do with your mother telling you, oh, you're the most beautiful girl in the world. It has nothing to do with that.
Wow.
And I want to make that very clear. A lot of girls run around, oh, my boyfriend thinks I'm cute, you know. Everybody thinks their girlfriend is cute. Every mother thinks their daughter is cute. It has nothing to do with that. It's an attitude. It's something that I look for in their eyes. Mm-hmm. You have to show me who you are. Mm-hmm. And don't just tell me, oh, I want to be a model, because that's very empty as far as I'm concerned. Everybody cannot be a Naomi Campbell. Mm-hmm. There's a few people who are born that way. And Naomi Campbell is one of the few. At 41, she's still kicking butt. Mm-hmm. You know? But everybody does not have that. It happens very rarely. It's a very rare business. It's a very rare occurrence, I should say, that a girl makes it to the top of the modeling game. You know, and again, with modeling, there are different layers of modeling. You want to be a hair model. You want to be a runway model. You want to be a print model. You have to know what kind of modeling you'd like to be. You know, so choosing models, I look for someone who can dance. Dance is very important. Yes, dance.
Why dance?
Because it gives you a certain amount of poise and elegance that, you know, you can't get from a modeling school. A lot of parents say to me, oh, I want to enroll my daughter in modeling school. I hate to burst your bubble. Nobody who's been through any Barbizon or any of those modeling schools have reached the top of their game. Sorry.
Is that so?
Yeah.
Walter,
check it out.
Let's take a break.
Research.
On that note. When we come back, I want you to talk about your conversation topic, one of it, which is what they don't teach you in the school. I think that's very important.
Okay.
So we'll take a break.
We'll be back.
I wanna be there for the drug addict. I wanna be there for the victims of violence and abuse. I wanna lend a hand, send to mommy now.
To mommy now, as he's way, he's oh yeah.
We are back. My guest tonight is Walter Green, the fashion designer. And what is the other thing, Walter?
Editor.
Fashion editor. Thank you, Walter. you're so multi-talented that, you know, I automatically threw in fashion designer there. And
I'll
I don't see
that.
Why not.
I'll take it.
Wayne just texted me, and he said he's absolutely correct. A lot of them, fashion designers, I believe, are in Brooklyn, I believe. Great idea to create a page for them on your site. Wonderful.
Wonderful.
So you see, the village is working. So Walter, back to you. Do you design or sew? Where do you buy your fabrics and other sewing materials?
I don't sew.
You don't
no.
sew? Okay.
No, that's the designer's job.
What are some of your favorite clothing store catalogs, websites? They're asking these questions.
I like The Gap.
The Gap?
I like The Gap. I like H&M. I like Macy's. I have a lot of friends with Macy's. Get a discount, I hope. But I like, I'm not big on shopping. It's the weirdest thing. I wear the same thing over and over again. Mm-hmm. Donna Dove, my shirt designer, she gives me my shirts.
She give them to you?
I see
Walter. I wonder why Donna
Dove. I'm the poster boy. I'm her muse.
Okay,
I'm the muse of Donna Dove.
How long has
she
been?
No, but she tries stuff out on me and see if it works.
Okay.
And she knows how I like to dress. I like to be very comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Comfort is the main thing. I travel a lot. I need stuff that I don't have to be ironing and all that. You know, I want to roll stuff up in one piece of carry-on, and I'm set.
Okay.
You know?
I mean, that's a very nice shirt. It's hand-painted.
Hand-painted.
Are her clothes reasonable?
I would say so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely. We have to get Donna on here so she can answer.
Oh,
all
she
those.
Will. She will definitely come on.
Donna, I hope you're listening.
What do you believe? What do you believe makes a quality article of clothing?
A quality article of clothing? The inside.
The inside?
Yes.
Why?
Because everything starts on the inside. It's like life. Somebody, you can look at them and say, oh, you're so beautiful, but are you beautiful on the inside? Back to that question you asked me about modeling.
Yes.
I want to see something inside come out. Mm-hmm. And just like beauty, the clothing. I remember judging a designer's competition one year, and this older fashion guru said to me, the first thing you look at when you're judging a designer outfit is on the inside. Mm-hmm. And I always remember that, you know, the workmanship. You turn a garment inside out.
Mm-hmm.
If the inside is finished properly, you guarantee to have a good piece.
Wow. And do you consider yourself an artist?
I'm an artist who I weave words. Yeah.
What matters to you most as a fashion editorial director?
What's the question?
What matters to you
most? What matters? Okay. What matters most is the content of what we're putting in the book and who we're portraying in the book.
Okay.
I want to see myself represented in the book. A lot of these magazines, and I don't want to call names, I may get in trouble. As I said, I get in trouble anywhere. But I'm really tired of looking at books, and it just speaks to one sect of the industry.
Uh-huh.
And that's what I was telling you about earlier on. This industry, it's not welcoming with open arms. That's what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
With our magazine or anything I write about, it has to reflect us. During Fashion Week in New York, we used to do Paris and London back in the day when we had a lot of money. But now for New York, and I sit there and sometimes I wonder who they want to buy these clothes when you have a lineup of 50 models,
mm-hmm.
and there are no models of color in that. Something
right.
is wrong there. Mm-hmm. And I was talking with Duro Uluru from, he's a designer in London. He just had a line at JCPenney's, and we talked about the same thing, and he echoed the same sentiments that I had in terms of seeing a runway of 50 models, and they're all blonde and blue-eyed.
Mm-hmm.
There's no, and not only black, but there's no black models, there are no Asian models, there are no Spanish models. It's a big world. This is 2013, and we are still excited when a black girl shows up on Vogue or Bazaar, which is very few, far, and in between,
mm-hmm.
you know? So I want to see myself reflected. I want to see myself reflected on the runways. If a designer doesn't show me, I wouldn't write about you.
Mm-hmm.
Some of my other editor friends, they call me the black girl's fashion police. Because if there's a show that I didn't make, my first question would be like, well, who are the black girls in the show? How many black girls do they have? You know, how many Asian girls? Any Spanish girls? It's a big world. And they're marketing to us, and we spend all this money with these designers who don't give a hoot about us. If you're not showing me on your runway, you're telling me that we're not supposed to wear your clothes. And that's a big issue. That's a big problem that nobody talks about. Everybody skip around it, and nobody hits it head on, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So in my own little way, I want to show us in our publication.
Are there many like you in the industry, A, and do they fight the same kind of fight?
Like oh, yeah, absolutely. But there's nobody like me in the industry. Come on.
Sorry, that's part
of the industry. You got to be individual. whoever's like me, I want to meet that person
right now.
But you know, there's people that who are like-minded that we, you know, we talk about this kind of stuff.
Talking about the play on me and all of this, if you, Walter, now,
mm-hmm.
met the 12, let's say 14, 15-year-old Walter,
okay,
what advice would you give him?
That's a tough one. I never even thought about that. Mm-hmm. What advice would I give him? Just not to let the little things get in your path, the unnecessary minutiae that comes up in the growth process in being a teenager. Little things. If I didn't worry about stupid stuff back then, you know.
Right.
But you don't understand it at that time, at that point. Mm-hmm. But as you get older, you see clearly why you went through what you went through.
Right.
And I always say, people say they go through changes. I say, like my minister does at church, you grow through changes.
Yes.
So I never said, oh, I'm going through all these changes. You grow through changes.
Great. I like that.
So I would tell that kid to just, you're going to grow through it. You may not see it now, mm-hmm. but down the line, you realize why you had to grow through that process.
And this question is not to say that at a certain age we can't do certain things. I mean, there might be some things that we probably may think twice about doing. But if you had more of it, you're much younger, is there an area in the fashion industry that you would throw your energy into, and B, out of the fashion industry you would throw your energy into?
Well, you know, times have changed. The fashion industry is different than it was back then. So it's
no, well, if with this knowledge and this experience,
okay.
If you were 10 years younger, but with this experience and knowledge, is there something else you, well, let's say 15 years younger, is there something else you would want to do within the fashion industry? Because you have age and youth on your side.
Right.
That's A. And B, is there anything outside of the fashion industry? Things that you have sat down and, you know, think about, you know what? If I weren't in the fashion industry, I would be doing this.
No.
No. Okay.
No.
What about
this? This is what I'm supposed to be doing. I mean, what else can I do? Mm. I can't drive a truck. mm. Although I may have a fantasy of being a truck driver. Right. That's not me, you know? It has to be something in the industry. Probably at an early age, with the knowledge that I have now and the energy, probably doing more business overseas.
Okay.
You know, setting up something probably, you know, in one of the African countries or something like that. But, you know, business overseas, you know.
Talking about that, and this is a question that comes up a lot in different shows about business.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have entertainers and you have people in different industries. They have like writers like authors like myself and so on. But how important is it for models to have strong business acumen?
They have. It's important because their life is their business. Mm-hmm. Their being, their whole, you know, the whole aesthetic, that's their business. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to take care of that business. You got to put money into that business because you are your job. As a model, as a fashion model, the hair has to be right, The nails got to be done. The body's got to be tight. Exercise is important. What you eat. I mean, the girls that are really working, mm-hmm. they're not out in the clubs 2-3 in the morning getting high or drinking or whatever. Because it shows on your skin.
Gotcha.
You get under the lights and the cameras and you can see everything. Mm-hmm. You know? You've got to live a clean life. And as much as you may see the models are out partying and everything, the smart ones would just, as I call it, they do a drive-by. They'd come to a function, they'd spend a half an hour, meet and greet, socialize, have a sip of champagne, mm-hmm. and they're in their bed by 12 midnight because they got a photo shoot at 7 in the morning.
So discipline.
Yeah, you have to be very, very disciplined.
And integrity. Not as a moral construct, but as
exactly.
a universal principle.
Because you are your business. Once you start falling apart, that's it. And the lifespan of a model is what, 5-6 years?
That short.
Yeah, maybe shorter. Now they have girls at 14 and 15 on the runways, which I think is a little bit crazy, because how can you be walking on a runway in a $30,000 dress and know how to carry it in a way that a woman of those kind of means would be able to do it? You know,
and I'm talking about age. I want to get in. I want to venture into sizes. You know, your friend mentioned tonight about full body models and so on.
Fiercely real.
Fiercely
real. Mm-hmm. We can't say full body anymore. We can't
fiercely
say plus.
Real.
Yes.
Thank you, Walter.
You have
fiercely
to thank.
Real.
Fiercely real.
Wow.
That term was coined by Tyra Banks.
Fiercely real.
Yeah, you're fiercely real. You cannot say full figured. You cannot say plus size. You cannot say large and
fiercely
lovely.
Fiercely real.
Fiercely real. Yeah.
Thanks, Tyro.
It's a big business. Uh-huh. And again, the industry, with all of their prejudices, they haven't touched that market. The majority of women are over a size 10. Mm-hmm. And they don't market to those women. Mm-hmm. They market on these little size 2 girls. Because the size of the pattern is a size 2. Few designers have ventured out and they cut for a larger size, which is the real population.
Right.
Come on, let's be real.
You know, I have heard along the way over the years that there are some designers are prejudiced to the point of snobbery, where they say they don't want to see certain people in
absolutely.
Their clothes.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. That's no secret in the industry. Mm-hmm. And they don't teach you that in school. Especially in modeling, when you go, I've talked to girls they go on a go see, they don't even refer to you by your name. You'd come to a casting and they'd be like, "Oh, we have enough black models." What other job could you go to and the boss, the whoever's hiring, tells you, "Oh, we have enough black model, black whatever, black secretaries, black computer, whatever." No other job does that, and for some reason they get away with it in the fashion industry. Oh, we have our code of black girls. Sorry, we can't see you. Or where is it? Like the person doesn't have a name. Oh, tell it to turn around. You know, it's very
it?
Tough. It, yes. And these girls, that's why I have a lot of respect for the real models. They have to pick their portfolios up with all that rejection and do the same thing over the next day. It's like going on 7 or 8 job interviews a day and being rejected for every job that you go on. There's one job for every 1,000 models who are out there beating the pavements. You know? One job for every 1,000 girls. Think about that.
Wow.
It's tough. That's why I have a lot of respect for the people like the Naomis of the world, the Leahs of the world, the Alec Wex of the world. I have lots of respect for those because I know what they go through.
It's strength and courage.
Exactly.
And determination.
And the it factor.
And
you've got to have the it factor.
So Wayne said, seeing that he's an advocate for black models as fashion shows, what does he think about including the full-figured women that truly reflects a lot of our Caribbean women?
I love full-figured women. I always have full-figured girls in my show. I work with a group called Diva Glam, Shauna Tisdale out of Texas. She runs it, and we've done a tour. We've been to Houston. We've been to South Carolina. We've been in Jersey. And we did a combination of the Diva Glam, it's called the Diva Glam Plus Size Girls with the big guys of the NFL. So it was a combination of the big girls and the NFL guys. And it was a successful tour. We've done that for a couple of years. I love full-figured models. And in my shows, I do shows every year. I always include the fiercely real girls.
What is your favorite part about conceptualizing a fashion magazine layout?
My favorite part of it? Mm. My favorite part of it, as crazy as it may sound, is having opposing views from my editor-in-chief or my publisher.
Is that so?
Yes. And, going at it to make sure what my vision is as a fashion editorial director goes in the book, okay? And not what a publisher may see,
right,
or an editor-in-chief may see. Because mm-hmm. I'm down in the trenches. I know what the deal is.
So do you fight often?
I wouldn't say it's a fight. It may be a difference of opinion.
Right.
Oh, no, I don't fight. We don't fight. There's no fighting in fashion.
But it seemed to go so well together.
It looks good. As I said,
like a sword and a sheep.
We make it look very, very easy. But it's really not. It's a lot of work. On the editorial side, it's a lot of work.
Okay.
You got to think of the advertising also. There's so many elements you have to think about, especially with smaller publications.
And how do you prepare for a fashion show?
For a fashion show or a shoot? There's two different things. For a fashion shoot, it's a lot of preparation. Mm-hmm. My last shoot we did was in Hawks Key in the Florida Keys. And what we did is we showcased two designers from New York, and I brought the clothes down. The model was from Miami. Again, determination. She drove in from Miami. She got to the hotel really late. And she was a trooper. Joanna DeRue, she's half Jamaican, and she was so professional. I mean, preparing the prep work that goes into it. I knew she was ready, because going into a shoot that big, you've got to have all the ducks lined up. Like, the nails are done, the body's ready, and the size, the clothing sizes. We didn't have time for a fitting. Luckily, she was a perfect size. Everything fitted her. The shoot went well. The prep has to go with the hairstylist, the makeup artist, so everybody's on the same page. So in the prep work is basically getting everybody on the same page, making sure that everybody knows what they're doing, everybody knows what goes where, who wears what shoes goes with this, what kind of lipstick goes with this photo. Mm-hmm. All the little details have to be ironed out. It's a lot of detailed work if you want to have a successful photo shoot. And I only have successful photo shoots.
Congratulations.
I've had my bad ones back in the day, but we wouldn't go there.
If you had to do this over again, what would you do differently?
Oh, my goodness. What would I do differently? Oh, wow. I don't think I would do anything differently.
You don't think so?
Nah.
Okay.
I like the challenges. I like the valleys and the highs and the lows and the craziness. And, it's part of the journey.
You spoke of sketching when you were a kid and
yeah.
so on. Do you sketch fashion designs?
I sketch, but for myself.
For yourself?
Yeah. Or I would sketch a storyboard of how I would discuss with a photographer how this look should be in the book. And I would do my little ugly little sketches, and, they get it. But I'm not a great artist as such in terms of sketching. Although some of my friends do think I sketch pretty good. Mm. But I've known people who are incredible artists that can sketch very well.
What do you like best about being a fashion editorial director?
Probably the travel.
Travel?
Being able to travel a lot, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how would you define your personal style?
My personal, you back to that personal style again.
Yeah. Well, you want to skip it a while?
Very simple. I'm very simple. I don't like getting dressed up.
Okay.
I mean, my friends can attest to you. I mean, it's just simple. Mm-hmm. Just simple and comfortable. When time comes to get dressed up, I can bring it. Okay?
And where do you get your inspiration?
Where do I get my inspiration from? For me personally?
Yeah.
From myself?
No.
I never put that much thought into
it. Okay.
Because I'm always like rushing, and I just want something that's comfortable.
Okay.
In the summertime, light colors. In the wintertime, it's a coat, it's a scarf. I love scarves. When I'm traveling, most of the time to the Caribbean, it's very light and easy. Cotton drawstring pants, flip-flops.
Okay.
A t-shirt.
Hmm.
I'm not fussy. Very simple. I'm not fussy at all. I can't put that much energy and effort into me when I'm putting it into somebody else. You know, like I'm on a photo shoot, my crew is usually, or even the backstage of a fashion show, the crew is usually in black, just basic black. But the focus has to be on the model.
On the model, okay.
Yeah. Got it. We kind of like fade into the background. I like that concept of fading into the background.
What has been the most defining moment for you as a fashion editorial director?
Defining moment?
Yes.
Oh, wow. My most defining moment.
Or one of them.
This is hard. It's been so many moments. I don't think I want to pick one out.
Okay, okay.
You know?
Okay.
But it's been, as I said, it's been a lot of highs and lows.
Right.
It's been, I don't want to, you know, I'm not into boasting of who I was with or who's our next cover, you know, but if you really want to know. Well, Beyonce is our next cover of the magazine.
Oh, congratulations.
So working with Beyonce is absolutely, I mean.
Wow.
What can I say?
So how is your job evolving from traditional print to online fashion editorial? What are the trade-offs?
It's a big trade-off, but we still have a huge online presence. The website is doing very good, you know, with all the tweeting and twittering and all that.
Okay.
Personally, I do not tweet. I don't want to be followed by a million people, or I don't want to follow anybody. Why am I following somebody? For what? What are they going to be teaching me? Mm-hmm. And I don't have time. As a serious journalist,
right.
It amazes me. If I have an assistant, probably I have somebody do that. But when you're writing 24/7 and that's your job, that's what you do, mm-hmm. What time do you have to be tweeting and texting all day?
I hear that.
Somebody need to teach me how to balance my time when I have deadlines.
Right.
You know, you have deadlines and publications. You have stuff to do. You got clothes to pull. You got models to see. What time do you have to be, you know, oh, I'm sitting on the train. Oh, I'm off to the store. Oh, I'm walking down the street. You know, I don't have time for that.
Who is the Fashion 98 magazine reader? And what message are you trying to convey to your readers?
The message is just that fashion is a lifestyle choice. We have to wear clothes.
Right.
Every single thing that you wear has been designed and created by someone. Mm-hmm. From your underwear to your socks to your stocking to your shirt to your cap.
And where is the magazine available?
It's available on newsstands. I don't have the list in front of me.
Oh, okay.
But or you can go to profiles98.com.
This question I got.
There's
asked.
A Pratt. There's
where
a Pratt.
That, sir?
Pratt Newsstand in Brooklyn.
Pratt Newsstand.
I think it's called. I don't know.
But your website.
Yeah, the website has a. If you click on where it says, I think it the section that says business or something like that.
What is it? Fashion98.com.
Profiles.
Fashion 98 profile.
No,
profiles.
Profiles98.com.
Sorry. Profiles98.com.
Right.
Okay.
And there's a section where you can look and see where it's, you know, distributed and stuff. Or you can go online or just, you know, pull your subscription online.
What is your daily habit to keep you grounded?
Prayer. Meditation. A walk in the park. Talking to certain people on the phone, mm-hmm. Venting, you know, quiet time. Quiet time is very important, especially as a writer.
Yeah.
You know.
That I can attest to that.
Quiet time is very important, yeah.
What makes Walter laugh?
Everything.
Everything.
I'm very silly, really. If you get to know me, you know. I like to be silly.
You know,
I have lots of nieces and nephews and cousins and stuff that are we have like a silly streak in our family.
I know one of your cousins.
Oh yeah, you told
me. Claire Clark.
That's one of my favorite cousins.
And I know she's probably sorry that this chat room is not working tonight because she had some questions for you.
She probably called me later and asked me the question.
Yes, yes.
No, Claire is wonderful.
She's a wonderful person. Caribbean women, so Wayne said, "What? Not sure if you give it, but what is the website for them?" Okay, yeah, we just give that. And you know, every time I say this every week, I approach a guest, and I said the show is 1.5 hours.
Okay.
Sometimes they say, "Oh my gosh, so long." You didn't say that, but the time goes. It's already, it's 5 after 10.
How long have we been on?
Well, we've had a few glitches in the beginning, so it's an hour and a half show. But I will ask you this, Walter. You're a grounded guy. To give us, take us out with some words of inspiration or, you know, something that you use for yourself or so on.
Oh, expect nothing and you would never be disappointed.
I like that. I like that. I like that very much. That's wonderful. Expect nothing and you'll never be disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much once again for spending your time with us. Our guest, Walter Green, has been eloquent as he has been candid. We have learned a lot. I want to thank you for your patience. Our chat room was not there, so we missed, you know, the third dimension was not with us. But as Walter said, everything is in divine order, and I believe in that. Everything happened for a reason. But once again, thank you. Walter said tonight that expect nothing, and you'll never be disappointed. I also believe in that. So this is Selwyn saying good night. But before I go, I want to wish my dear friend, Allison Booty, a very happy birthday. And Allison, wherever you are, I hope you're having a terrific time. You're enjoying yourself. You deserve it. You're a beautiful person. Happy, happy birthday. Good night.
The luminescence shining for you and I is a star, brighter than the sun inside.